man of the moment, Bobby Orr, number four.
And Yaz makes a fine backhand diving catch for the out.
Once in a while, an athlete comes along who captures our imagination.
A great save by Bobby Orr.
Who transcends the boundaries of sport.
Throws to second. Here comes Jackson. Here comes the throw. He's out.
Who's more than an all-star or Hall of Famer.
And Bobby Orr has set a new National Hockey League record.
An athlete who becomes a legend.
Gremsky coming on and makes great pass.
Bobby Orr, behind the net to Sanderson. Orr!
There goes the ground ball. Base hit! Number 3,000. Yastrzemski's got it. And all hell breaks loose at Fenway Park.
Here in New England, we have been both blessed and privileged to have more than our share of legends, where guys like Orr, Williams, Bird, Yastrzemski, and Russell aren't just names in the newspaper, but flesh and blood heroes. People we've grown up and grown old with. Men who we've cheered for and cried with.
Orr is down and hurt.
Tonight, we take a look at two of New England's living legends. Number 8, Carl Yastrzemski. And number 4, Bobby Orr.
The line is Orr. Orr is on the gallop. Going in. Drive. Goal! Ball tied up!
High fly ball deep to left field. Yastrzemski going way back. Way back. And he makes a one-handed catch in the fence.
Orr. Getting daylight up through center ice. Whacking in. Shot kicked out. Another shot. Great save. Oh! It's hard for nothing.
Base hit to center. Lundborg scores. Adair will score. It's tied up.
Orr outskates Burns. Over the line. Oh, he's hauled down by Barrett. In for Dusick. Score! And a play by Dusick and Bobby Orr, who's flat on the ice.
Little soft pop-up. Petrucelli will take it. He does! The ball game is over! The Red Sox win. And what a mob on this field. They're coming out of the stands from all over.
Maneuvering, just a head fake, and he breaks. He's over the line. Going deep on Lysiak, and he goes behind the net, hustle up, and it's scored! Bobby Orr, what a goal! What a goal, short-handed!
I also like to thank all you fans in New England who supported me for 23 years to have made this possible here today. Thank you very much, and I love you.
I spent 10 years here in Boston. They're the 10 best years of my life.
A lot of companies make it difficult and confusing to buy life.
Right, that ball is good, and it is gone. A home run for Ted Williams in his last time at bat in the major league.
In the spring of 1961, the eyes of Red Sox Nation were focused on left field, on who would fill the void left by the retirement of Ted Williams.
That was the toughest thing I had to face. It almost cost me my ability to make the big leagues. I would have liked to have come in unnoticed. You know, being on all the covers of magazines as the next Ted Williams. When I came in, I completely changed my style. I used to be, until 67, Boggs type hitter, or Tony Gwynn type hitter, hitting the ball left center, right center, base hit, stuff like that. When I broke in with the Red Sox, I just turned 21, and I was more or less a singles and a doubles hitter. Taking his place, I tried to become a home run hitter, and the most home runs hit to mine was like 15. It just completely changed my whole thought. Geez, at the All-Star break, I was hitting maybe 220, 230. And I'll never forget, Mike Higgins was the manager at the time, and he came up to me and he said, you know, you have to be yourself. You can't be Ted Williams. There's no one like him. And from that point on, I think I hit like 330 the second half of the season, and I knew that I belonged in the big leagues. But it's Carl Yastrzemski, not as Ted Williams.
Should be good for extra bases. Two runs are coming across. Yastrzemski digs for three. Triples.
It didn't take long for Yaz to establish himself as one of the game's best. In 1963, he won his first batting title with a 321 average, plus earned the first of seven gold gloves in left field.
Yastrzemski makes the catch.
I love playing defense as well as offense, getting a base hit, hitting home run, throwing a guy out, keeping a guy to single when he hit the ball off the wall. I loved it when it was the original wall, where it was 20, 30 feet up with cement, no padding. Then you had this tin with rivets in it all over the place. The ball hit and go to your right, left. It would never come back through to you. I just love playing it, and I practice and practice and practice it. And defense meant as much to me as offense. I can remember, like, it was fun for me playing defense at Fenway.
Lines one down the left field line. It's hard off the wall. Here comes the throw to third, and Kipper.
But during Captain Carl's early days, that was about the only fun he had playing baseball. From 1960 to 1966, the Red Sox were one of the worst teams in the American League.
To finish last, next to last, my first 6 years with the Red Sox was tough. If I was going to leave the Red Sox, I probably would have left then, because I can remember in 67 when we were going for the pennant, completely changed the game around for me. It was fun again. I can remember the national press interviewed me the last month of the season every day and said, how do you take the pressure? And I told him, I said, this is fun. There's no pressure in this. The pressure was my first 6 years finishing last. You better get two or three hits at the ballpark or you'd hear about it. And we had no one at the ballpark. I think the most we ever drew was like 800,000, 700,000, something like that. And it wasn't fun.
Well hit toward left center. It is. Number 41 for Yastrzemski.
The impossible dream season of 67 profoundly affected not only Carl Yastrzemski, but the entire Boston franchise and all its fans.
Well, I think the whole Red Sox organization was changed in 67. We became winners. Whereas even in the minors in 59 and 60, it was almost the losing atmosphere carried down to the minor league system. We were losers. Then 67, we became winners. And from then on, we were competitive every single year. Like I said, it's fun to win. It's fun to be in a pennant race.
Roar winds. Here it comes. Fly ball to deep left. Yastrzemski is going hard. Way back, way back. And he dives and makes a tremendous catch.
At the Fleet Center.
Where are the tickets?
Well, you show me what you got. I don't know what
section. Give me what I got.
You got the tickets.
No, dude. Don't do that.
This is so juvenile. What do you mean?
You don't have tickets.
No. TV host needs two. Thank you. Two, anyone? Tickets. Tickets, anyone? Need two. Just need two. TV host. One. I'll take one. Anyone? One. I'll just take one. All I need is one.
Classic Games, Jurassic Guys. Fanatic, Sundays at 7.
Carl Yastrzemski, Carl Yastrzemski, Carl Yastrzemski, the man they call Yaz, we love him. Carl Yastrzemski, Carl Yastrzemski, Carl Yastrzemski, what power he has. Our Boston team is always on the beam, cause we got Yaz. We Fenway fans, we stomp and clap our hands, and Yaz is jazz. Rival pitchers on the mound all shake. They dread each windup that they have to take. When number 8 is standing at the plate, and then he swings. Whoa! There it goes again!
Though players like Jim Lonborg, Tony Conigliaro, Jose Tartabull, and Rico Petrucelli had great years in 67, the spotlight belonged to Carl Yastrzemski as the Sox charged down the stretch in one of the tightest pennant races in history. Yaz, quite simply, was awesome.
Deep to right field. Number 44.
It just happened that last month of the season, everything broke perfect for me. They couldn't pitch around me. The leadoff man and the second hitter were always on base. Whereas the following years, it didn't happen that way. They could pitch around me, walk me with men on base and things of that nature. So the situation just felt perfect the last month of 67.
Yaz hit 417 with 9 homers and 26 RBI over the last month of the season, winning baseball's last Triple Crown and personally carrying the team to its first pennant in 21 years.
Little soft pop-up. Petrucelli will take it. He does!
Bet all back.
What can I say? What 7 for 8 in the final 2 biggest games of your life? You're too much.
I was just trying the best I could, Don, and I had something going for me. I wanted to win it for Mr. Yawkey. He deserved it.
How do you account for having such a phenomenal year? I mean, is it just one of those things where you feel every time you go up that you're going to get a base hit?
I just felt great physically. Felt confident at the beginning of the year because I felt so great physically doing all those exercises. I graduated from college last winter. I didn't have to worry about it during the winter time going back to studies or anything. I had a winter to rest and relax, and I just felt great when I started spring training.
The 1967 World Series pitted the Sox against the St. Louis Cardinals, led by Lou Brock and Bob Gibson. And though Boston would ultimately lose in 7 games, it provided Yaz with memories for a lifetime.
That was a great World Series in 67. You know, they talk about the 75 World Series. I think the 67 World Series was just as great. I can remember Lou Brock having that great first game. And all of a sudden now he's leading off the inning in the first inning in the second game. And now he's when he stole 60, 70, 80 bases. Where Lombre hits him on the first pitch to let him know. Boom. And then the third game we go to St. Louis and Nelson Brown nails me. That was a competitive World Series. I like to see what would have happened if we had a healthy Conigliaro or we had Lomberg with 3 or 4 days rest. And Lomberg has never complained about that. Gibson talked to me constantly every time I came to plate. I'm going to strike you out. You're not going to get a hit off me and stuff like this. And I yelled something back to him. This carried over until 68 in spring training. I think like the 4th game of spring training. We only play 3 innings. There was the matchup of Gibson and Lomberg in St. Petersburg. And geez, I come into the box and here comes Gibson, walks off the mound right toward me, I'm gonna strike you out and all this stuff and that. And I hit a double off him or something like that. And I was standing on second base, had a big grin on my face and he was just pointing at me. And he said, you're lucky you don't play in the National League because I nail you right in the head, you know. And that's how competitive the guy was.
Despite the heartbreak of the 67 series, Yaz soldiered on, piling up gold gloves, another batting title, and more. But it is that magical Triple Crown season of 67 for which Yaz will always be most remembered and of which he is most proud.
I have to say that because when I picked up the papers, Sox win pennant, and in this story, Yaz wins Triple Crown. That's how much your focus was on one pitch at a time, one at bat at a time, trying to help the Boston Red Sox win. I've always said, if I wasn't in the pennant race, if it didn't go down in the last day, I would have never won the Triple Crown. Because everything that I've done individually for myself, it took me a long time. 14, 15 at-bats to get the 3,000 hit. I don't know how many at-bats to get the 400th home run. Both of those occurred when we weren't involved in any type of race. We were already out of it. So without any doubt, I would have never won a Triple Crown if we won in a pennant race, and it had to go down to the last day.
...9800.
Bet it pitch.
track, looking off it, gone for a homer.
As Carl Yastrzemski headed down the back stretch of his career, there was lots of drama still to come, but unfortunately, a lot of heartbreak as well.
3-2 pitch to home, and a bounding ball, second base. Doyle throws to first. It's over. It's over. The Red Sox win the pennant. What a night. The Boston Red Sox are American League champions for the ninth time in their history.
You know, I compare that team exactly to the 67 team. Here you had in 75 Lynn, Rice, Burleson, all these fine young ball players coming up. I thought both teams would be dominant. I thought both teams would win or come close to winning every single year.
There it goes, a long drive. If it stays fair, home run.
I was in a dugout. This had been a tremendous comeback. We were kind of down. I can remember that because going into the seventh inning, we were down by 3 runs. And then Bernie Cobble hits that 3-run pinch hit home run. All of a sudden, everything changed. The whole atmosphere changed in the dugout. Now, we were thinking of winning the World Series. Then when Fitz hit the home run, I thought the next day it was impossible for us to lose.
There's a high fly ball. It should be all over. Geronimo's under. And Cincinnati has won the World Championship, beating the Boston Red Sox 4-3.
The 75 team, I thought, boy, this is great because now it's the end of my career. I said, boy, I'm going to be in a pennant race every single year. And when Lynn and Burleson left, it just kind of took a lot away from me. You know, you could see the pennant kind of drifting away every year because you don't lose these caliber players. And then, of course, Fitz left. And what should have been wasn't.
Heavyweight championship fight, Super Bowl, as Carl Yastrzemski said, and a World Series all wrapped up into one. That's what we have today. And
the disappointment didn't end in 1975 for Yaz or for Red Sox Nation. In fact, the cruelest blow was yet to come in the 1978 American League East playoff game.
Ball hit hard to left field. Yastrzemski goes back. He looks up. It's going to be out of here. A home run for Bucky Dent.
When he hit the ball, I never expected it to go out. I went back and I started decoying that I was going to catch the ball. I figured it was going to hit halfway up and boom, I'm retrieve the ball and keep the men on base and stuff like that and have nobody score. When that ball went in the screen, it's just like the life came out of me. I couldn't believe it, not alone because it was a home run, because it went in the screen. I just couldn't believe that ball went in the screen. I thought it was going to have trouble hitting halfway up on a wall.
It up. Greg Nettles at third base. Backing up, he makes the catch, and the Yankees have won the division. The Yankees have won the division, beating the Red Sox 5-4 in a game that will go down in history as one of the most memorable, hard-fought contests ever.
You know, you go back and take each one of those individually, you can say 67 thing. We had Caniglio, Lomberg had more rest going to that seventh game. 75 World Series, again, the fist thing being blocked out on a bunt. Did that play a big part in the World Series? Even in the seventh game, the bloop single, broken bat single for the winning run. The playoff game, so many things happened in that game that we should have won the ball game. The play that Lou Piniella made, it shouldn't have even been close. I thought we should have won that game by 3 or 4 runs. It just seemed everything went against us. So you look back and say that everything went against us, naming all those things. But yet, we had a shot. That was the main thing. We had the shot and we didn't do it.
As Captain Carl entered his final seasons with the Red Sox, he began to reap the rewards of his longevity and his consistency.
We're following him in his quest for home run number 400. Long drive, right field, way back, near the wall, and there it is! Home run number 400, Carl Yastrzemski.
and watch.
Has been hit by Karl Yastrzemski, and watch him. Up everywhere at Fenway Park. They want a curtain call for Karl Yastrzemski. So we've had a gigantic moment at Fenway Park, and it's still going on. A rolling, rolling, swelling groundswell of applause.
Still looking for number 3,000. There goes the ground ball. Base hit. Number 3,000. Yastrzemski's got it. And all hell breaks loose at Fenway Park. I will miss you. I will miss my teammates, past and present. And I hope I represented Boston and New England with class and with dignity.
On October 3rd, 1983, Karl Yastrzemski retired.
It was a tough moment for me. I really didn't want to retire. I thought that I could still play another year or two. But then I knew that I couldn't go through the workouts. I just had it. I couldn't work out all went along, which I knew I had to do in order to play. So I didn't want to embarrass myself. So that day I looked in the mirror when I was shaving, and I asked myself a couple questions. I said, could I have worked harder than what I had? And the answer was no. Could I have gotten more out of my ability than what I had? And I said, no. And that kind of cheered me up a little.
A couple signs I saw, and they said, say it ain't so, yes. I wish it wasn't.
When I gave the speech, I didn't know what I was going to do after I was finished. And then I said, well, I've got to do something. So I said, I'm going to run around the field. I think why I did it, I think I wanted to show the fans how much I loved them and that, and how much I appreciated this sport.
He was elected to the Baseball Hall of Fame on his first ballot in 1989. And later that year, Yaz's number 8 was officially retired by the Red Sox.
To me, having my number retired at my home here at Fenway Park is a greater honor to me as having been elected to the Hall of Fame. I also like to thank all you fans in New England who supported me for 23 years to have made this possible here today. Thank you very much, and I love you.
I was a working class ball player. I wasn't anything special. I had to work 1,000 times harder than anybody else just to have some success.
All the shock and
CDs are 2 cassettes, plus $3.99 shipping and handling. 2 Classic Jazz, Department 3, Richmond, Virginia, 23280. Or order online at timelife.com.
God is far.
It seems as though it was only yesterday, but it's more than 30 years now since a young man from Ontario, a boy, really, arrived in Boston and changed everything. His name was Bobby Orr. The story of Bobby Orr starts in the small town of Parry Sound, Ontario, where even at a young age, his amazing skills were noted. When he was only 14, Bobby signed on to play junior hockey with the Oshawa Generals.
First of all, what number will you be wearing?
Number 2.
And, of course, you scored 30 goals as a defenseman. Does that mean that you have eyes perhaps to becoming a forward, or do you still want to stay on defense?
Well, I think I'd like to stay on defense.
Well, we have a picture of one of your goals where you took a shot and then got a big rebound. Now, how come you were there waiting for the rebound? Was that just luck or what?
Yes, I think it was just lucky.
You also like to make a rush every once in a while and wind up behind your own net and move it in. Do you like to come in and shoot at that instance, or do you look for the play to make?
Well, just depends. If there's a man in the open, everyone likes. Like, if there's a man in the open, then we'll pass it. Try and make a pretty good play, and if I can see something to shoot at, I'll shoot.
When he was 14 years old and he was playing with the Oshawa Generals, I was 14-year-old playing bantam hockey and going to Maple Leaf Gardens to watch junior hockey, because they would have the double headers in those days, and saying, this guy's my age playing junior against the guy's 20 years old. And it was amazing.
You know, my dream was to play in the NHL, and you know, by the time I started working a little more, you know, I was then playing junior hockey, and you know, I knew that I had to get in a little better shape, you know, going into the season. But I think when you're young like that, you don't really get out of shape. But you know, I didn't need a fire under me. I, you know, it's my dream. I knew the next step, you know, minor hockey to junior hockey, and then after junior hockey, I would get a chance at the NHL. And it was my dream, so you know, I didn't need anyone pushing me, and I didn't have anyone pushing me. I was very lucky. My parents, you know, they bought my equipment and they supported me, but never did they ever say, you're going to be a professional hockey player.
We went up to see two players play that particular night by the name of Eaton and Higgins. They were on our list. They were soon forgotten because we saw this little kid, this toehead, crew-cut kid with his pants down below his knees on the defense, and he just took things over by himself. Eaton and Higgins never were a part of the Boston Bruins after that.
Before playing a minute in the NHL, Bobby had already started to change the game when he enlisted the help of Allen Eagleson, the first player agent in NHL history, to negotiate his contract. The deal turned out to be a record breaker and helped change the salary structure of the entire league.
Well, we signed the contract on a boat with Hap M's in Barrie, Ontario, and I remember getting the call to, it was the summer, I was up at Halliburton Hockey Haven as an instructor, and I got the call to come down that we were gonna do a contract, and you know, the contract was great and everything, but I was thinking, well, boy, I'm gonna get a chance to play in the NHL. That's what I was thinking about. I really wasn't thinking about the money or bonuses. I knew now I was going to get a chance to go to a training camp and see if I could play.
The jump to hockey's big time was a memorable one, and not just because Bobby had realized a lifelong dream, but for the lifelong friends that he would make.
I checked into the hotel and was given a key, and I went to my room and I opened it up, and there was a guy laying on the bed. He looked like Buddha. Sorry, Chief. And I looked at him and I recognized him. It was Johnny Busick. I said, "Hello, Mr. Busick."
Well, when he first came in, you know, the first thing is, "Hi, Mr. Busick," and we got rid of the Mr. pretty darn quick. And you know, from then on, it was John and Chief, and you know, we became such close friends, and to this day, we still are. And it was just a great feeling, you know. I mean, we never even thought about the age difference. Never bothered anybody. I think at that time, they respected me for all of the years that I played for the Bruins, and I had a lot of respect for these youngsters coming up. So we got along very well.
You know, a lot was written about this rookie. And they could have made it very difficult for me. The players are so great. You know, I was very shy, and you know, I didn't want to go out. They insisted that I go with them. They would come and drag me out. They were wonderful. I mean, even the guys whose jobs I was trying to take were great.
We saw him as a shy rookie. I can remember, I was saying that, in fact, we had him over for dinner one night, and it was Mr. Cheevers, Mrs. Cheevers, et cetera. And I said to my wife when he left, I said, you know, it's going to be a month and it's going to be Mr. Orr, you know that. But he was so, you know, he just came so prepared and was very cognizant of what he should do as a person and as a player. And he was just, it was just class, that's all.
It was immediately apparent that along with being almost painfully shy, he was also one of the greatest hockey players who ever lived.
Orr across the line, going in, shot, goal!
The American flag. It symbolizes freedom and justice for all mankind. Throughout the land, millions of Americans are proudly displaying the flag. Introducing the American Freedom Collection. A set of two quick display flags, one Old Glory flag and the exclusive God Bless America flag. Each flag is made of weatherproof, fade-resistant material. They attach to your car window in seconds. Just slide the slot in the window. It's that easy. It looks great on mailboxes, bikes, trucks, even inside your home. The American Freedom Collection also includes four reusable peel-in-place flags. There's no glue. Just peel off the flag, and it'll cling to any smooth surface. Call now and receive your personal American Freedom pin. You get everything. The Old Glory flag, the God Bless America flag, the peel-in-place flags, and flag pin. The entire American Freedom Collection for just $14.99. Call now.
To order your American Freedom Collection for only $14.99 plus shipping, have your credit card or checkbook ready and call 1-800-750-1441.
Orr going in alone. His shot, goal!
Bobby Orr hit Boston and the NHL like a meteor streaking across the sky.
Bobby Orr legs it back up through center ice. Cuts deep. Goes behind the net. To Esposito. Shot, goal!
As a defenseman, Bobby's aggressive offensive style and incredible puck-handling skills were a phenomenon, something never before seen.
Get by Parise. His shot. Goal! It's went up in Bobby Orr. Scored for the Bruins. His 23rd goal of the year.
Some of the highlights of Bobby when he had the puck and controlled the game. I mean, that's what he did. He controlled the game. He controlled the tempo, the speed, and did an awful lot of scoring. He really revolutionized the game for defensemen and brought the game into the 21st century.
Gordie Howe at the time could do everything on the ice, but he did it at a speed that wasn't comparable to Orr. And Bobby Hall had the speed that Orr had at the time, but he couldn't do what Orr could do. So Orr was the only player that could do everything at high speed.
He's, in my mind, the greatest player in the history of the game. And I don't say that because of his talent on the ice specifically, but he revolutionized the game of hockey. He changed it forever. Defensemen had never come close to winning the scoring title. He won it twice. I mean, that's awesome. I mean, he is the greatest player. He changed the game forever.
His 100th point of the season. No other defenseman in the National Hockey League history has ever done it.
The once moribund Bruins franchise was revitalized by Orr and the trade that brought Phil Esposito, Ken Hodge, and Fred Stanfield to Boston.
Orr down the right side. Feeds across. Esposito back to Orr. Goal!
Suddenly, the Bruins were winning. Boston Garden was full. And the excitement was everywhere.
Going into that season, the 69-70 season, you know, we really felt great about our team and felt that if we continue to progress the way we had, we're going to be fine and that we had a shot at it. And we really felt that. We weren't overconfident or cocky about it, but we were a very close group on and off the ice. And that's the way we thought we had to be to win. We knew we had a pretty good team. And we knew, and we felt that if we worked hard and stayed together and everyone did his job, we would be fine. Going into a season like that, you knew if you're going to be the champion, if you're going to be the winner, you knew what Esposito was going to do. You knew what a lot of the guys were going to do. But we needed, you know, the Marcottes, the Donny Orrs, the Dallas Smiths, Ace Baileys. We needed those players to play at the top of their game. You've got to have those guys.
Everything did come together for Bobby Orr and the Bruins in that 1969-70 season. Orr won the Hart Trophy as league MVP, the Ross Trophy as scoring champ, the Norris Trophy for best defenseman, and the Conn Smythe Trophy as playoff MVP. The only man ever to collect all four. But most important, for the first time since 1941, the Bruins won the Stanley Cup.
Wide and Keenan cleared to Bucknotto. Bobby Orr behind the net to Sanderson. Orr! Bobby Orr scores in the Boston Bruins have won the Stanley Cup. And Busick skates around with the cup to the roar of the crowd. Johnny Busick, the great
pretty difficult to describe. And I think the thing that, you know, that was the year Teddy Green was injured, and once we got to center ice, I can still remember looking over the bench and seeing Teddy standing on the bench with, you know, tears coming. I mean, it was something. And then of course Johnny Busick skating around. Like growing up, we saw that so often on television. Carrying the Stanley Cup high over the shoulders, or whether it be the Forum or Maple Leaf Gardens or the Olympia in Detroit, and following Johnny around with the Cup, that was pretty special.
And there they go, the Boston Bruins skating off with the Stanley Cup, Johnny Busick having it high over his head. What a moment for the Bruins and their fans.
Back here at the Bruins dressing room, two oars. Bobby and his dad, Doug. Congratulations, Bobby, on a tremendous victory.
Thanks, Don. It's so great. I don't want to say this team, unbelievable. The guys that are hurt, they're out yelling for us between periods. They're in the stands, they're fighting for us. The guys that are playing, goaltending, we put everything together. Just a great bunch of guys. Great.
Winning the Cup set off a celebration of epic proportions across New England. A joyful pandemonium that still stands as one of Boston's great sports moments.
We know we have made the grid. Read about us in the papers. We have got it made. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. We're on top of the world. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. We're on top of the world.
City, it was a nice crazy. You know, I don't remember that there were any serious problems or anything that I can remember. The parade in Washington to City Hall, it was unbelievable. I don't know how many people were in City Hall Plaza. A lot. But it was fabulous. You know, my father was here. He was in the parade, which was really special, and it was. Yeah, a lot of fun.
And the fun wasn't over. Bobby Orr mania swept the region. New rinks sprung up all over New England. Kids around the area began imitating their new hero.
Now to Orr, breaking. Here comes Orr. Right in. He shoots it.
And the Bruins continued to be successful, winning a second Stanley Cup in 1972, setting off another memorable celebration back in Boston. But even as New England basked in the glow of Bobby Orr and the Bruins, a dark shadow loomed in the future.
Here's Busick and Orr. Spun around by Bergman, still has it, backhanded, kicked out by Edwards. We've got a penalty coming up. Orr is down and hurt, and so is Frank Mahovlich. They're both down and slow to get up as they collided.
Stanley Cup in 1972, but even as Bobby racked up more scoring titles and Norris trophies, injury and treachery were conspiring to do what no one on the ice could, stop him.
Bobby, precisely, what about the knee, or can you comment on it now?
No, it just gets a little sore, and within the next couple of days, I'm going to see our doctors, and they're going to decide, and if they decide they're going to operate, they'll do it, I think, around the second week of June.
I was doing something I love to do. I mean, I was having a blast. I mean, even the pro level, I enjoyed going to practice. I mean, I wanted to go out and perform. I really, you know, with pressure and confidence. I don't think I really started feeling pressure until I couldn't do what I once did, the way I did it, because of my knee. The key to my game was skating, and you know, all of a sudden I couldn't skate like I used to skate, and then it's really started to bother me. I mean, laying in bed at night, worrying and thinking about it, and so on and so forth. And if that's pressure, that's when it really started to bother me.
Bobby had been plagued by knee injuries since 1968. As the years went, the game continued to take its toll on Bobby Orr and his knees, but despite the surgeries and constant pain, he refused to quit.
What a stop by Bobby Orr!
Bobby played with a lot of aches and pains, his toes, his feet, and his ankles, and his knees, and And he was the type of a player to, he wanted to be on the ice. And, you know, he always felt that he could do more than some guys could do with two legs. And he was right, and he did. But it shortened his career for him. And you could never tell Bobby when he was hurting a bit, don't play, take another day off. No, no, he says, the team needs me, I got to go out. And he was so dedicated to the organization and to the team that he would play hurt. And I think that's why his career was so shortened, is because his knees went too darn soon.
After appearing in only 10 games during the 1975-76 season, Bobby's contract was up for renewal. It was during these negotiations that the Bruins, Bobby Orr, and all their fans were betrayed by Bobby's longtime agent, Allen Eagleson.
In 1976, the Bruins offered Bobby Orr 18.5% ownership of the club, or $925,000, as part of a new contract coming up. Mr. Eagleson wrote a letter back to then Bruins president Paul Mooney declining the offer.
My agent said Chicago was offering you a better deal. It was accepted, and I went on to Chicago, not realizing the Bruins had a better deal on the table, which we find out later.
The first time he ever saw that letter was in 1990. He had no idea that the 18.5% had been turned down.
It was an offer that should have been accepted. It was a better offer than the Chicago offer, but it happened, and what do you say?
It's tragic because he got robbed from the Boston fans.
The loss of Bobby Orr was a crushing blow to Bruins fans across New England. Its effect on the Bruins franchise was nothing short of catastrophic.
His imprint on hockey fans of Boston was something that was really, really tough to deal with once it was gone. We lost all our season ticket holders to speak of. We had something like 13,000 season ticket holders. Bobby left in June, and by the time the season started, we were down to about 5. That's the impact it had.
In Chicago, Bobby gave it his all, but after 6 serious knee operations, there was just nothing left.
I now know I'm no longer able to play.
After going to Chicago, I took a year off thinking maybe, you know, time will heal it. And yeah, I just couldn't play anymore. My game was to skate, and I couldn't skate anymore, and it was just too tough. I was sore longer. I didn't heal as quickly, and then just, you know, finally I said, hey, it's time to say it's over. And I took a long time to really make it final because I wanted to make sure. Maybe I could have played. Maybe I'll try to come back. When I quit, I knew that was it. There was no chance of me ever playing again.
The man who definitely needs no introduction, number 4, Bobby Orr.
Bobby Orr played his last game on November 1st, 1978. His achievements speak for themselves. 8 consecutive Norris trophies, 8 consecutive All-Star appearances, 3-time league MVP, 2-time scoring champ, also the first defenseman ever to win a scoring title, 2-time playoff MVP, and on the list goes.
I spent 10 years here in Boston, and they're the 10 best years of my life.
But when Bobby looked himself in the mirror and said, what's next? He and his family knew where they belong.
This is a heck of a place. I love you, and thank you very much.
When I retired and I knew I could no longer play, time came when we had to decide where we wanted to live. And it didn't take long to decide that, you know, we'd come back to Boston and live here. We have a lot of great friends here. We love the city, and we decide this is it.
Bobby Orr and Carl Yastrzemski are both happily retired and still living here in New England.
Area.
Bobby is an agent and a principal of the Wolf Associates Sports Agency and still working on his golf game.
Oh, do I go that way?
Yaz does a lot of fishing. Plus, he spends time in Florida each winter, where he still works with the Red Sox as a hitting instructor. While Bobby Orr and Carl Yastrzemski are no longer the fair-haired idols of our youth, and that now more than ever our thoughts of them are tinged with melancholy and what might have been, all of us here in New England can take pride that numbers 4 and 8 were ours. That in our memories, Carl Yastrzemski is the 27-year-old Yaz who gave the Red Sox back to Boston in that impossible dream of 1967. And that Bobby Orr will always be the Bobby Orr with good knees, forever suspended in championship glory. That they will live on forever in the hearts and the minds of people of New England as true legends of the game.
I think at this point we should just refrain from, and he's going to go, there's no question about it.
Phew, I have to whine though.
He got it now, look at it, 2 for 2.